President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. directs local government units and relevant government agencies to provide assistance for victims of Typhoon Aghon. Marcos says food, health services, and evacuation centers are all being mobilized to help affected communities. Marcos also urges the public, especially those living in the storm's path, to stay vigilant and prioritize their safety. Four people reportedly injured as Typhoon Aghon continues to batter the Philippines. The Office of Civil Defense says three children and a 30-year-old male from Albay sustained injuries after a tree fell on a tricycle they were riding. Meanwhile, over 2,000 were also affected in the Bicol and Eastern Visayas regions, with nearly 40 families displaced and taking temporary shelter. The Philippine government assures the public it is doing its best to assist Filipinos affected by Aghon.
We take this seriously. We don't leave anything to chance. No, ibig sabihin lang po nito, all hands, lahat nandito, plus may mga augmentees pa tayo from the different uniform services.
Some air and sea trips also suspended due to the bad weather. The Philippine Coast Guard advises the public to postpone their travel, with about 2,000 passengers still stranded in different ports across the country. Our weather watch as Typhoon Aghon slightly intensifies over the Philippine Sea. Let's get the latest on the storm's track from PAGASA forecaster Veronica Torres. Hi, Veronica. What do you have for us?
Good morning, Ms. Bettina, and to all of our audience in ANC. So currently, we have an update for the tropical cyclone that we're monitoring. And as of 4 a.m. today, it's at 105 kilometers east of Baler Aurora, and it's slightly intensified over the area of the sea east of Aurora. So it's moving 10 kilometers per hour with a speed of 140 kilometers per hour near the center, and gustiness up to 170 kilometers per hour. And because of Aghon, we still have signal number 2 over the southeastern portion of Isabela, the northern portion of Aurora, and Polillo Islands, while signal number 1 over the eastern and southern portion of Aurora, the eastern portion of Quirino, the eastern portion of Nueva Vizcaya, the rest of Aurora, the eastern portion of Nueva Ecija, the eastern portion of Bulacan, Rizal, the northeastern portion of Laguna, the northern and central portions of Quezon, and the western portion of Camarines Norte, including Calaguas Island. So for the heavy rainfall outlook, we have 50 to 100 millimeters of rain we're expecting for today over the eastern portion of Isabela and the northern portion of Aurora. And also, we also have gale warning raised over some parts of the Philippines, so please be careful when venturing out into the ocean. And we're expecting Aghon to exceed the Philippine area of responsibility on Wednesday afternoon or evening, still as a typhoon. And that's the latest from PAGASA Weather Forecasting Center. Veronica C. Torres reporting.
Hi, Veronica. Just one quick question. Are we expecting rains here in Metro Manila until Wednesday?
So with regards to Metro Manila, for today and also tomorrow, we're still expecting cloudy skies with scattered rain showers and thunderstorms due to southwesterly wind flow. Although we're expecting this for today until tomorrow and improving weather condition by Wednesday.
Okay, great. Thank you very much for that update, Veronica. Several local government units in Luzon have suspended face-to-face classes today, May 27, due to rains and flooding caused by Typhoon Aghon. Here's a look at the list. More than 670 people fear dead following Friday's massive landslide in a remote village in Papua New Guinea. Previous estimates place the number of fatalities at 300, but the International Organization for Migration said the death toll may be more than double, with the full extent of the destruction still unclear. Most of the fatalities could be children. So far, only 5 bodies have been retrieved from the rubble. Dangerous conditions on the ground also continue to hamper aid and rescue efforts. Over in the U.S., at least 7 people were killed in Texas after a powerful tornado struck over the weekend. Valley View is one of the hardest hit towns, where the tornado ripped through homes, knocking down power lines and leaving debris strewed across fields. Dozens were also hurt, with many of the injuries reported at a gas station where people attempted to seek shelter. The full extent of the damage is still unknown. The destruction continued a grim month of deadly severe weather in the U.S. 12 people on board a Qatar Airways flight were injured during a bout of turbulence. The flight was bound for Ireland from Doha, and it landed in Dublin as scheduled. Passengers say the incident lasted for about 20 seconds and occurred during food and drink services. Qatar Airways, meanwhile, said all injured passengers and crew members received medical attention. The airline is investigating the matter. The incident comes days after a Singapore Airlines flight encountered severe turbulence, killing one passenger and injuring dozens, including Filipinos. Davao City Mayor Sebastian Duterte slams the removal of dozens of police officers in his city due to alleged drug-related killings. The Philippine National Police has relieved 35 cops in Davao following an investigation into the deaths of 7 drug suspects killed in a separate by-bust operation last March. This also happened shortly after Duterte declared a war on illegal drugs in Davao. The son of former President Rodrigo Duterte asserts the drug operations are legal and the removal of police officers appears to be an abuse of power by higher authorities. Mayor Duterte now calls for accountability as well as the immediate reinstatement of the relieved officers. Israeli airstrikes kills at least 35 Palestinians and injured dozens in the southern Gaza city of Rafah. The strikes took place in a neighborhood in western Rafah, where thousands had sought shelter after fleeing eastern areas where Israeli forces began a ground offensive 2 weeks ago. The International Committee of the Red Cross says its field hospital in Rafah was receiving an influx of casualties, and other hospitals were also taking in a large number of patients. Israel says it launched strikes on a Hamas compound and was aware of reports that civilians had been harmed in the incident. Many of the wounded are in critical condition, and the final death toll is unclear. Hamas launches missiles at Tel Aviv, setting off sirens in Israel's financial center for the first time in 4 months. The Israeli military says a number of the projectiles were intercepted and that there were no reports of casualties. Hamas says the rockets were launched in response to the massacre of civilians. The attack signals the Islamist group is still being able to fire long-range missiles despite 7 months of a devastating Israeli military offensive. The Prime Minister of the Palestinian Authority expressing gratitude at the courage of 3 European countries to recognize the Palestinian state. Spain, Ireland, and Norway painted their decision as a move aimed at accelerating a ceasefire in Gaza and reviving stalled peace talks. Attending a meeting with international donors in Brussels, Mohamed Mustafa said he was grateful the 3 had effectively joined 143 countries that backed a Palestinian bid to become a full United Nations member in a resolution earlier this month.
We're still hopeful as Palestinians that many decades of struggle and working towards independence are coming closer than ever before. These efforts, these announcements, these meetings are key building blocks towards making Palestine independent, sovereign, viable state a reality.
EU Foreign Police Chief Josep Borrell, meanwhile, stressed the importance of returning to the political process and gathering international initiative for a two-state solution.
And I think that we have to discuss about how we can put this into practice. Maybe a conference can be a useful step to gather international initiative and direct our collective efforts towards this end.
Israel has called plans for the recognition of a Palestinian state a prize for terrorism. Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky appealing to U.S. President Joe Biden and Chinese leader Xi Jinping to join an upcoming peace summit as his country struggles to stave off unrelenting attacks by Russia. In recent weeks, Moscow's forces have made significant advances in the east and the north. Kyiv is hoping the June meeting in Switzerland will help pile international pressure on Russian President Vladimir Putin and show the world really what the war and show the world really wants the war to end.
Please show your leadership in advancing the peace, the real peace, not just a pause between the strikes. The efforts of global majority are the best guarantee that all commitments will be fulfilled. Please support the peace summit with your personal leadership and participation. For all of us, it should be a pleasure to make peace near our border.
Zelensky's comments come 2 days after Russian forces revealed Putin was ready to halt the war in Ukraine with a negotiated ceasefire that recognizes current battlefield lines. Let's find out what stories our North America Bureau is pursuing right now from our Bureau Chief, TJ Manotok.
Good morning to the friends of the Rundown. Here are the top stories making the headlines in the North American region.
We honor Maria Ressa.
We begin with Filipina Nobel laureate Maria Ressa delivering an impassioned appeal to this year's graduating batch at Harvard University to continue speaking up for the truth. The journalist, who is the CEO of news site Rappler, was the principal speaker at Harvard's 373rd commencement ceremonies in Cambridge, Massachusetts. She also received a Doctor of Laws honorary degree from the Ivy League school.
Amid times of unrest, facing threats and arrest, she rivets her focus on facts, truth, and trust.
Ressa, in her speech, spoke of a troubled world at an extremely challenging time amid disinformation and hate on the internet. Ressa recounts she was the subject of online attacks allegedly orchestrated by the Philippine government in 2016.
Social media turned our world upside down, spreading lies faster than facts, while amplifying fear and anger, fueling hatred by design for profit. Whether it's the AI of social media or generative AI, we don't have integrity of information. We don't have integrity of facts. And here's three sentences I've said over and over. Without facts, you can't have truth. Without truth, you can't have trust. Without these three, we have no shared reality, no rule of law, no democracy.
In sports, the Filipino-American gymnast has qualified for the Summer Olympics. UCLA junior Emma Malabuyo took home bronze at the all-around competition at the Asian Gymnastics Championships in Tashkent, Uzbekistan. A former Team USA alternate, the Milpitas, California native, scored 50.398, qualifying her for the Summer Games in Paris, France, where she will represent the Philippines. Malabuyo joins recently crowned NCAA champion Alea Finnegan of Louisiana State University and Stanford-bound high school senior Levi Jung Ruvivar as part of the Philippines women's gymnastics team. 2020 Olympian Carlos Yulo is the Philippines' lone men's representative. Yulo himself bagged 4 gold medals at the Asian Championships. And finally, 24-year-old Chelsea Manalo of Bulacan, Philippines, bested 52 beauty pageant contestants and made history by becoming the first Black Filipino woman to be crowned Miss Universe Philippines on Wednesday. Speaking to ABS-CBN News, Manalo says her big win hasn't quite sunk in yet.
Even if I am the first African-American Filipina to compete for Mexico City, I know that I'm going to do great. There's a story to tell here, and I hope that this can bring me the fifth crown to the Philippines.
Manalo grew up with a Filipino mom and a Filipino stepfather, but always wondered about her biological dad, an African-American.
When I saw him in the States, it was when I was about 10 years old now. Mm-hmm. I was in grade school. I met him there. I was there for 2 years.
Ah, okay.
Yeah.
So you lived in the U.S. for 2 years. Saan?
In Las Vegas, Nevada. I was
with
there
your dad?
With my Lola.
Even when she went back to the Philippines after living for 2 years in Las Vegas, she says she kept in touch with her biological dad prior to his passing. a tourism graduate, is an advocate for youth empowerment. The 2024 Miss Universe pageant will take place in Mexico on September 28, 2024.
And those are the top stories making the headlines in the North American region. You can catch more of our TFC News on our website, news.abs-cbn.com/TFC News, and head on over to the ABS-CBN News YouTube channel. I'm TJ Manotok. Back to our friends at the Rundown.